I think I can start with three medical jokes this week. When we move back into the sanctuary, this joke thing will be over. Until then, I think we need some entertainment value. One, my cousin has the Amish variation of the COVID virus. First, he got a little horse, then he got a little buggy. Two, patient, doctor, you've got to help me. I think I'm a kleptomaniac. Doctor, don't worry. I think there's something you can take for that. Three, this guy finally invested in a hearing aid and after being virtually deaf for a long time, it was one of those invisible hearing aids. The doctor said, well, how do you like your new hearing aid? I like it great, said the patient. I've heard sounds in the last few weeks that I didn't know existed. The doctor said, how does your family like it? The patient said, oh, nobody in my family knows yet. I'm having a great time. I've changed my will 3 times in the last 2 weeks.
Wah, wah.
What kind is it? Oh, about 11:30. Onward. The comedian Chelsea Handler recently posted a note in Facebook. I went to Canada and my ski instructor gets health insurance for $15.95 a month, $15.95 a month. If people don't make enough money, they get health insurance for nothing. Why the heck can we take better care of our own people? It seems that in Canada, they consider themselves all to be Canadian. In Denmark, they consider themselves all to be Danish. But here in the United States, poor people are considered to be lesser beings, trash, subhuman, unworthy of medical care, housing, or a decent diet. Our medical care is rationed so that those who have resources get to live longer. We'll talk about that in a minute. But first, it seems now that medical care is also being weaponized and used against some people, the transgender people, by an ignorant subset of the political powers, the Trumpista Republicans. I can't even say conservative Republicans, because at least one sees it as an unwarranted government overreach into the personal choices of an individual, which is a solid Republican viewpoint. I have to go over this account from CBS News. Arkansas's Republican governor, Asa Hutchinson, vetoed a bill on Monday that would have restricted healthcare procedures for transgender minors. Transgender rights have become a new flashpoint for Republican lawmakers nationwide. He said, I was told this week that the nation is looking at Arkansas because I have on my desk another bill passed by the General Assembly that is a product of the cultural war in America, Hutchinson told reporters while announcing his veto. He said the bill, while well-intentioned, is off course, calling it an example of vast government overreach that would create legislative interference with the physicians and parents as they deal with some of the most complex and sensitive matters involving young people. The bill, called the Save Adolescents from Experimentation Act, would have banned gender transition treatments, including surgery and hormone therapy for people under 18. Arkansas would have become the first state in the nation to outlaw these practices if Hutchinson signed it. My note, if you've been watching the Table Talk video series the past few weeks on adolescents dealing with being transgender, you know that it is a delicate process, demanding and exhilarating and devastating. And the idea that the government is going to intervene between a family and its doctors seems to me to be a very antithetical to what being a traditional Republican is all about. What I hate about this is that there's hardly a more vulnerable, defenseless population anywhere than a transgender teen. And while this governor is a traditional Republican, his legislature is Trumpista. Back to the story. The governor further criticized the bill for not continuing care for transgender youth who are already receiving these treatments. "We want to send a message of tolerance and diversity," he said. Arkansas's GOP-led House and Senate passed the bill last month, mostly on party lines. Republicans have enough votes to override Hutchinson's veto with a simple majority vote, something the governor said he already anticipates. In fact, they did override his veto. He said, "I am hopeful, though, that my action will cause conservative Republican legislators to think through the issue again and hopefully come up with a more restrained approach that allows a thoughtful study of the science and ethics surrounding the issue before acting," he said. Didn't work. There was no call from their ethics telling them to back off. Hutchinson's veto comes less than 2 weeks after he signed two other bills that restrict LGBTQ rights. He's no saint. One bill lets doctors refuse treatment for patients based on religious or moral objections, a move that critics said would allow for LGBTQ people to be turned away from medical care. I think doctors have a vow that says first do no harm. While turning patients away, I think does harm. The other bill bans transgender women and girls from participating in women's sports teams. Arkansas was the second state in the U.S. to approve such legislation after Idaho, whose law has been halted by a federal judge. At least 25 states have seen similar measures proposed. Four states so far have passed the bans into law. South Dakota's legislature passed a ban on transgender women playing on women's sports teams, but Republican Governor Kristi Noem said that she did not believe the bills would survive legal challenges, and she instead issued a ban last week by executive order. The wave of bans comes after President Biden reversed many of the Trump administration's LGBT restrictions, including a transgender military ban. End of article. You can read more about this in today's New York Times in an article by Frank Bruni, and I posted the article on our Facebook page. It's a really great article. Now, transgender soldiers have been accepted in the US military since 2016. Think about that. The military had no trouble with transgender soldiers, okay? But it was banned by Trump in 2018 by executive order. President Biden's restoration of LGBTQ rights has prompted a reaction from the Trumpistas to fight against the rights of the LGBTQIA plus population in as many ways as possible nationwide. The level of medical intolerance represented by Arkansas reduces the value of the humanity of transgender people in the community at large. The transgender person's rights are being removed. In places like Arkansas, where doctors can refuse to treat them, it makes it easier to consider them to be subhuman, and therefore easier to kill. 37 transgender people were killed in the US in 2020, and 350 were killed worldwide that we know about, up from 330 in 2019. Many are put in danger because they have trouble getting jobs or a place to live because the law does not protect their housing or employment rights. They can be refused employment or housing based on freedom of religion, which means the freedom of Christians to discriminate against them. In desperation, they can end up being trafficked, especially if they are teens kicked out of the house, which makes them very vulnerable to murder. So withholding medical care and attention from the trans community is a weaponizing of medical resources, one step beyond the scarcity of medical resources that the US has as policy. Without the Affordable Care Act, health insurance is available only through one's employer, and they can hold that over your head. How many times have I heard someone say, "Oh, I hate the job, but I need the insurance"? Healthcare is rationed out in the United States, and those at the bottom get the worst of it. People of color are the hardest hit by COVID because they have not had a steady supply of health maintenance. They cannot afford most medical care. That makes them more vulnerable to the disease. So Black men die of COVID at a rate that is 6 times that of white men. The Brookings Institute says this: Blacks relative to whites are more likely to live in neighborhoods with a lack of healthy food options, green spaces, recreational facilities, lighting, and safety. These subpar neighborhoods are rooted in the historical legacy of redlining. Additionally, Blacks are more likely to live in densely populated areas, further heightening their potential contact with other people. In Michigan, Blacks make up 15% of the population, but about 40% of the COVID deaths. And overall, Black people live in densely populated areas where they're heightening their potential contact with other people. In Michigan, Blacks make up 15% of the population, but about 40% of the COVID deaths.
Chuck?
Overall, Black people live in densely populated areas
where they're
heightening their potential contact.
Well, it's playing back over me.
Yeah.
In Michigan, Blacks make up 15% of the population.
About I don't know what's happening.
COVID deaths. Chuck?
Wow. Here I thought I was going to have a perfect time this today.
Well, it's almost perfect.
Yeah,
I'm going to go back to the Michigan line. Are we ready?
Yeah, I might have to cut us off of Facebook if this keeps happening. Go ahead.
In Michigan, Blacks make up 15% of the population, but 40% of the COVID deaths. And overall, Black people make up 13% of the U.S. population, but account for at least 23% of coronavirus deaths, according to the COVID tracking project. This disparity is an indictment of our entire medical system. We do not distribute according to need. Dr. King said it best, of all the forms of inequality, injustice in healthcare is the most shocking and inhumane. In our reading from Acts today, we read about a community of extraordinary generosity. Let's hear it again. Now, the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. A sense of community love, sense of love of God. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses, sold them, and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. So this ideal setting in the early church was doable for a time, but maybe not sustainable. This early church portrayed here may have been of the same beliefs as the Apostle Paul, who was convinced that Jesus was coming back soon, like any minute now. Instead of holding land and feeding people from the income over time, they sold the property and fed people with the money until it ran out. And we need not feel ashamed or embarrassed because we have not followed this example. There's a lot of extreme language in the New Testament that we don't have to follow. My favorite one is from Jesus, is found in Luke. Quote, whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even life itself, cannot be my disciple. End quote. This is one of the arguments that Jewish theologians have for not following Jesus, because they cannot imagine what he's talking about here, hating everyone in the family, because in the Jewish tradition, the family is the center of everything. But what Jesus was talking about is really that we must put God first if we are to follow Jesus. He just chose a very confrontational means of describing in extreme language what that would mean. So what we see in this description of the sharing community in Acts is an ideal, an aspirational viewpoint on how we should try to live. But it can be done, living in community and generosity. The Diné, whom we incorrectly call the Navajo, have a saying, you cannot get rich if you take proper care of your relatives. We white people have a general policy of wanting to get rich first. How about this as a stated ideal? There was not a needy person among them. Can we do that? When we see someone who is in need, do we assume it is because they are lazy? What if we see them as unlucky, or possibly they have a mild mental illness? What we have learned about working with people who are experiencing homelessness is this. The best thing we can do to stabilize their lives is give them a place to live. Once that happens, we find that they can build the infrastructure that sustains them in the future as good, stable tenants. But with no place to live, they cannot make a stable life that allows them to find a place to live. And why can't we distribute medical care to each as each has need? Commercial medical insurance takes money out of the system instead of building up the medical infrastructure that would have been able to better absorb the shock of COVID-19 without losing 500,000 Americans first. Medical people estimate that 400,000 of those deaths so far could have been prevented. In other words, the previous president killed more Americans than died in World War II out of negligence, incompetence, and maybe worse. As we Presbyterians practice our faith, we see that the followers of Jesus are a countercultural movement in the United States. Our aspirations are towards a caring community, one that heals people without charging them for it, which makes sure that the hungry get fed, the thirsty get drink, that the homeless get housed, that those who mourn get comforted. We don't expect others to do that because it is not in their self-interest to do so. It is not to their competitive advantage to do so. It is not the act of the rugged individualist to help the weak. We should not be surprised when we see this habitual brutality spelled out. And in fact, it is important that we do not turn away from it, because we need to speak against it, to take action against it when we see it, and to vote against those who perpetrate it. That means we have to nurture our own stamina. It used to be easier to ignore the suffering, but the scales have fallen from our eyes. It is important for us to stay in shape, to find quiet, to pray whenever it comes to mind, to look for joy and experience, to look for joy and experience it so that we can get through the times of suffering, our own and that of others. God does not call on us to use God's love as an escape route. We are to use it to be alive in the world, with everything that that means. Jesus did not back down. Neither should we. Let us pray. Dear God, who lives and moves and breathes within us, our world is in rough shape, and some are trying to make it worse. We have noticed they try and pick out the weakest among us. Help us to stand up for them, to put ourselves on the line for them, to take up their pain as our own. All this we ask in your name. Amen. Thank you.